So I've been watching this documentary. I did watch this documentary on Netflix called Crack. It's really good. There's obviously a little review here on The Guardian, but essentially it speaks about the crack epidemic that kind of swooped all across America. They kind of highlight a lot of the story sort of touch points come from New York mainly, but essentially talking about the crack epidemic in a in the 1980s and how that affected politics and socioeconomic stuff, and obviously issues with race and war, blah 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 blah. But it's so well done, very well put together, an easy watch, about 1 hour 20 minutes if that. Loads of interesting people kind of speaking on it, loads of kind of all cool talking heads. But the most disheartening part of it is obviously the conversations that have been had with former crack addicts who are now kind of in recovery, who are basically speaking about the damage that that drug did to their lives and obviously their families, and the fact that, well, one lady in the documentary, she's missing a few teeth and she looks really gone. And then you see a picture, an image of her when she was younger with her two daughters, and she's talking about how she basically left lost them through the drug, obviously going through various stages of turmoil, just loads of inner family strife, and she's just basically alone in this studio talking about how hard her life has been. And it just really hits you, man, of how devastating the crack epidemic was in America during that time, man. It's really eye-opening. And again, it's just funny to see how naive or how kind of blissfully unaware or unwilling they were to be aware of the actual issue that was going on, especially with the government, right? When it comes to dealing with a crack epidemic, and they decided to have this, initiative with the Just Say No, right? I think that was Ronald Reagan's wife initiative, and they legitimately thought that that was gonna do it. They even recorded like a song with loads of well-known celebrities, like a jingle thing. They did adverts with, of course, well-known actresses and actors during the time, and it's just mind-boggling to think that at that time they thought that would be the thing to end the crack epidemic in any sort of substantial way. And this is obviously after the fact that they kind of painted it as a black problem. They painted it as a thing where, black mothers were giving birth to crack babies. They painted it as a degrading drug that kind of brought out the worst in people, but then they weren't demonizing cocaine in the same way that was kind of indulged by the more affluent, upper class, fairer skin type people in America. It's a really good documentary. I really recommend you check it out. This obviously a review here from Netflix. It says the war on drugs founded by policing. Behind Netflix documentary about crack, it says in a myth busting new film, director Stanley Nelson looks back at the crack epidemic in 1980s. It says here, nestled in Jungle Fever, Spike Lee's meditation on the interracial love in a harrowing depiction of how the crack consumed corrupts. In a supporting role, Samuel Jackson plays Gator, a man who's ferociously possessed by the drug that he at one point storms his own mother's home and runs off with a television set which he sells to fuel his addiction. Later we find him in a Taj Mahal, a Harlem crack house that looks like Hades, surreal, decrepit and filled with hundreds of lost souls. References to the crack epidemic have swept the United States in the 1980s and the 90s are not lacking in pop culture, though hardly are we given the kind of sweeping portraits that the situ distributing sorry disturbing and outrageous individual stories like Gators within a broader social and political trajectory. Crack, cocaine, corruption and conspiracy, the latest documentary by Stanley Nelson provides just that, weaving personal testimony with former dealers, users with insights from historians, scientists and other experts. Crack provides a history of one of the nation's greatest failures, one whose ripple effects remain a large part of today. And I recommend you check it out. I really do. It's really good. And it's funny because it got me thinking. I was watching it, I was like, what it basically means, like ethically and morally, if you're vegan, you can't really take any class A drugs, can you? You can't do ket, you can't do coke, you can't do meth, whatever. You can't do nothing really apart from smoke weed if you're legitimately a vegan and you live that lifestyle, because you can't deny the blood that's on your hands when you're inhaling those kind of class A substances. There's no way that you can kind of distance yourself from it at some point along the journey of that drug getting from origin to you. It's definitely had some blood trickle down the side of it for sure. That was kind of one of those kind of things I got from it. And of course, because I think there was a few interviews on there actually with former dealers who have obviously, you know, felt like they had a lot of karmic consequences coming their way for the strife that they caused, obviously, during the years. Some were not so repentant, who kind of saw it as a way to boast. But for the most part, it's pretty harrowing. It's not as bleak as I'm making it seem, but I recommend you definitely check it out. It's a amazing, amazing, amazing documentary. Like I said, what's it called? Crack, Cocaine, Corruption and Conspiracy, available now on Netflix. We'll also have here another review of a show that I liked or that I love, that I've actually finished the entire season of, Spiral on BBC iPlayer. It's, I think, available on other platforms regardless of where you are in the world, but god damn it, quite possibly one of the best, if not the best, cop drama of all time. And I stand on that. I really do. And again, I've watched The Wire, I've watched The Bill in the UK we have here, I've watched The Shield, right? Spiral is the best. And if you don't know Spiral, the English name, French name is Engrenage. It's a French or Parisian based cop drama. It's amazing. If especially if you're non-European, it definitely gives you a bit of an insight into the strife and the struggles of inner city life within a European city that you're probably not familiar with, from racial tensions, economic disparity, classism, just loads of really cool perspectives that you get from just a cop drama. Because imagine how many people, because this is what you forget with, that's why I love cop dramas. Because for the most part, they get to see the kind of the glitz and the glamour of whatever city that they're in, and also the underworld, right? So you get to see both sides in real time, and they have a and it's kind of coming from so many different perspectives. Like, you know, there's people working in a police force who have obviously been grandfathered in, people with from affluent means, people that don't have any other option. So you get all that kind of internal struggle within the police force itself. And then of course, when they go and interact with the wider community, it's just, you know, an entire cacophony of just, you know, psychopaths trying to make sure they don't shoot each other down. But Engrenage is really, really good. I'm a big fan of it, mostly because of the obviously the European connection, obviously because of the seedy kind of underground organized crime side of things as well, right? The fact that, you know, for as much security and regulations and red tape that surrounds the import and exports of certain things, they always seem to cross our shores in some underhand way. And most of it has to do with the just a kind of complex web of criminality that seems to have seeped through major parts of Western Europe. But I really, really recommend check it out, man. And the protagonist in it, the what well, I guess the main kind of lady, Caroline Proust here, who plays what's her name? I forgot her name in it, but yeah, she's really good. It's an incredible, incredible series. If anything, this is maybe the best example of what Michael Burnham in Star Trek Discovery should have been. You know, Michael Burnham, so I've stopped watching it, right? After I think whatever season three, it just got ridiculous. She disobeys every single order. She does what she wants. She kind of flies off the seat of her pants. You know, she doesn't get punished for her actions. No consequences to it. She always saves the day. Everyone always has a way for her. It's just stupid. But with this series, she's probably the, I've got what her name is in here. What's her name? Prowse, is it? Jolene or Lee? I forgot her name. Doesn't matter anyway. But this character in Engrenage, Spiral, they kind of portray her perfectly because she's just broken. Right, and whatever trying healing that she's trying to get through her job, she never finds it. Whatever trying love and affection she tries to find from people within her workplace, also she doesn't get it. She then ends up in a completely toxic relationship towards the end of the season. When I'm not going to spoil anything, but she ends up in a very toxic relationship towards the end, where it kind of essentially takes them both down in a way. But there's always, like, along the way of watching this show, there's always points where you just feel like it's all gonna go away. She's just gonna crumble and die. Something tragic is gonna happen to her. And of course it doesn't, but in terms of just, there's always that kind of feeling that it might happen. Whereas in Star Trek Discovery, you never ever get the feeling that Michael Burnham is ever gonna be in trouble for anything, right? Or she's ever in danger. And you're sort of complete opposite, obviously, with Engrenage. So this is from New York Times. Read a bit of the review here. They said, courtesy of Mike Hale. He says, the long-running crime drama Spiral, its French title, where it premiered at Canal Plus back in 2005, called Engrenage or Gears, does not take place in a postcard Paris. Oh yeah, that's another part of it too, Paris. I've been there twice, right? First time would obviously on my own. First time wasn't that great. I kind of didn't have a connect, and I kind of didn't really see the hype of Paris. It kind of felt a bit stuffy, a little bit well-to-do. And then the second time I went, obviously, for Virgil's fashion show for Off-White, that might have been 2017 or something. I forgot when it was. And that was great because I obviously got the red card treatment. I was going to go to a fashion show. I was working on something with him at that time, doing an online course for Master, the previous company I was at. And then I got to see a completely different side of Paris, right? I got to see it in how it's actually meant to be experienced with locals, with people sharing you around places, you know, going behind velvet ropes, secret doors, underground bars, you know, lock-ins, all this sort of stuff. That's how you're kind of meant to experience it, right? Walking around the city for an hour's on end, looking for people to hang out with. Like, that was actually how you're meant to experience it. I was like, oh, amazing. But then watching a show, you get an entirely different idea of it too, because they film a lot of it sometimes within the outer rings where most of the sort of immigrant community are based in. It's just eye-opening. It's incredible. It's incredible. Torres and Landmark picturesque boulevards are scant. The Eiffel Tower occasionally appears in the hazy distance like a mirage. The show's eighth and final season begins with a shot of the Sacré-Cœur, how do you pronounce that? But the camera pans down to the working class Barbès district, where the dead body of a homeless Moroccan teenager is found inside a laundrette. So again, they always start the season usually with a striking image, and that first episode of season 8 is quite possibly one of the best representations of why Engrenage is amazing. If I'm not mistaken, there's like a Middle Eastern kind of dude walking down the street carrying a box, going to work, doing whatever. As he's crossing the road, a group of teenagers, you know, quickly zip by him on an electric scooter. And if you've been to Paris, you know everybody rides those e-scooters, right? Lime, wherever they're from, they're so popular, they're everywhere. So you see him kind of nearly getting run over by someone on the scooter. He crosses the road, and then you see a really great car. You see the cobbled streets, of course. And then as he's crossing to come over to his laundrette, there's a contrast between a really amazing pearly kind of yellowy stone building, and then he's sort of like spray painted, you know, iron steel sheet kind of laundrette before he's kind of crossing over. So you get that contrast, and it's like a snapshot. It's like maybe it's 5 minutes max, that scene, but it's a perfect encapsulation of why Engrenage is absolutely amazing. I definitely encourage you to check it out, man. It's probably one of my, again, one of the best cop dramas of all time, including English language. Trust me, I've watched them all. Too many to mention, but like I said, it's better than The Wire. No, it's not better than The Wire, it's better than The Shield. It's probably up there with The Wire. But again, if you're into cop dramas, check out Engrenage Spiral, available on all streaming platforms for you to check out.